The next one I would like to raise is the ad hominem fallacy. This is where someone attacks the person who is making the argument, as opposed to the argument itself. Ad hominem fallacies try to disprove an argument by focusing on the character of the person. I think God's existence is necessary based on the concept of a perfect being. No, you're wrong. You're just a Bible-bashing Christian who cannot fit into a modern world. Insulting a person's character does not mean their arguments are invalid, and we should only focus on the arguments raised rather than who is saying them.
It's really an amazing opportunity for me to be able to talk about the ethics of crime reporting, which is something I'm extremely passionate about, and I'm so glad to see that there's other people interested in this as well. I'm a reporter, so I'm going to start with a story. And since I'm a crime reporter, it's going to be a bad one.
And what started, like, a bunch of, like, people, like, ragging on me and corporate media outlets saying bizarre behavior.
Sorry for that, but I assume you folks probably knew what you were getting into when you came here this evening.
Well, that's libel. And in Hawaii, you can post pictures all red tint going like this in Kai's corner. This is what I look like when I do this, by the way. Yeah, in real life, okay? So if you take all the red tint off of that, that's Kai's corner for you, baby. Yep. In Hawaii, you doctor up a photo to make somebody look bad, and you can get sued.
Care about nothing, and you just do the job. And are we using the pain of others for our own entertainment? One tweet that has misinformation in it from a reporter can do so much damage, and it's not just to that story and the conception of that story, it's to media, the trust with media, your organization, your byline. Crime stories are also about accountability. to question the systems and the people that govern us. There is an old adage that justice is not done unless it can be seen to be done. And the media has a significant role in that. We are the eyes of the public. Done properly, crime reporting can be profound and powerful. It can be a way to give a voice to the voiceless or to help someone find their voice. It can do what all good journalism should, tell interesting, important stories that matter. What H.L. Mencken and many others have actually said is journalism's duty, to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable.
Right, yeah.
You seem like you're a trustworthy and confident guy, and I got some confidence in your honest reporting.
Well, that's what I'm in it for. Like, the last article, I'm actually, you know, it's like I tell people, I write to live. This is my livelihood. But I live to write to make a difference.
What kinds of details are too much to be included in sexual assault cases?
Hey, Kai, how's it going?
It's going great. Are we recording right now?
Yes, we are recording.
All right, I will just launch right into this and listen along and then let me know at the end if you have any questions about it, okay?
Okay, great.
All right. In the grand jury transcript from November 13th, 2013, is posted up on Facebook on the Kai the Hitchhiker legal support page. On page 9, the prosecutor said, Kai showed no signs of being raped. There was a rape kit done on Joe. No semen was found. End quote. So they admit that Galfi's semen was a sign of me being raped. You can look at the forensic lab report that I also posted up in the photo albums for proof that his semen was found. On page 18, the prosecutor said that Joseph Galfi was lying on the floor dead. Lying on the floor dead. End quote.
Mm-hmm.
But they lied to you through the media and said he was found in his bed.
Right.
On page 22 to 23, the prosecutor said dark hairs were removed from the side of the bed and Mr. Galfi had gray or white hair.
Mm-hmm.
So the short hairs, they were on the side aspect of the bed near the floor, on the vertical aspect, and proved that the rapist shoved my head into the bed when I awoke and hit him. And also, it proves that I cut my hair before I went back.
Oh, wow.
Also, on page 23, the prosecutor said there was no semen found on any of the bed sheets and the master bedroom. End quote. The rape happened on the carpet, which they told the sheriff not to analyze. They told the sheriff what to collect and what not to collect. This is another lie of omission, and it's a lie of influence to trick the jury.
Mm-hmm.
On page 25, the prosecutor let slip, and I quote, and the botch. The prosecutor was so guiltily aware that they didn't collect all the bottles that he let out that Freudian slip.
Oh, he literally said botch.
He literally said, and the botch.
Ho-ho.
On page 35 to 36 of the grand jury transcript, the prosecutor said, and there was also some empty beer bottles that were collected. And he goes through a bunch of other stuff, and he says, and they were all swabbed for any contact DNA, and they're still being examined by the lab. End quote. So first, he buries the reference to the beer bottles in a bunch of other stuff. And then he makes it seem like the bottles are being examined by the lab.
Right.
But in fact, the bottles were already rinsed out at that time, and he knew it. On page 41, the prosecutor said, a rape kit, which was performed on Mr. Galfi's body, came back and was negative. End quote. So he's misleading the jury into thinking That meant the rape kit showed that I wasn't raped. In fact, it was negative for signs of the rapist being raped.
Right, that's... Wow.
But there was science of him committing a rape.
Okay.
His semen and unidentified blood, which is presumed to be mine, were found on his penis.
Yikes.
And they knew that at the time.
Oh, God.
And on page 91 to 93, the prosecutor said, as part of your investigation, you have to follow up on Kai's statement that he was raped. And so you talked to a doctor who said any kind of date rape drug would last 10 to 12 hours. End quote. So they admitted to having the duty to bring me to a doctor, but instead they hired Robert Pandina, who has never even been to medical college, to give an opinion that Wikipedia can prove wrong.
Mm.
If you want to disprove it for yourself, you can look up GHB and Ambien. And they both have acting times of between 1 and 4 hours.
Right, yeah.
You can be woken up before they're finished. Mm-hmm. And the thing about them is their drug effects are exactly what I went through. The loss of memory, the walking places and not knowing how you got there.
This call may be recorded or...
Subscribes up a code, I'd say about 6 or 7 times for between 1 and 2 weeks on each occasion. The whole point for me and for most people with it is with insomnia, it kind of throws your pattern out of whack. Your body gets used to not sleeping, it doesn't want to sleep, your patterns go all over the place, you don't know when's day, when's night. It's about Zopiclone in terms of side effects. Was when you wake up in the morning, and everyone reports this, your mouth will taste like you've chewed a piece of steel or some sort of metal because it tastes metallic and it does not go throughout the day. Like, by the time you fall asleep, it's gone. But you brush your teeth, have a cup of tea, but it still lingers. I suppose it's better than having no rest at the end of the day, but it's a really odd thing. It's not like distressing or anything, it's just a bit odd. Not the nicest of things. And again, when you first wake up, you will feel, or I have felt, very, very drowsy the morning after taking Zopiclone. Only lasts for about an hour or two, at most, for me.
I woke up with my pants down, and I was pulling the pants down, and I hit my black belt. And the night before, I'd stayed with him. He picked me up in New York. He says, oh, you look lost, you know, like, where are you from, this and that. And I says, Dogtown. He says, and I said I was going to New Jersey. And he said that he was headed to New Jersey, too. So I went with him to his house. And when I was at his house, he gave me a bunch of beers. And then I got kind of sleepy right before bed. I woke up, and it was like, there's a metallic taste in my mouth, and there's like, cum going down inside my face, and I felt violated. I went over to Asbury to meet a friend, and she wasn't showing up. I called him, didn't have any other place to go. I went and I ate some food with him. He had made some burgers, like some homemade burgers, then I don't remember much after that. I woke up on his floor and he was over top me trying to take my pants down, and I started hitting him. I just blacked out. Okay, so you woke up on the floor? I woke up on the floor of the room. Okay. I'm just going to tell you one more, okay? We made the trip all the way down here, so he died. So just listen to me. We made the trip all the way down here. We want to hear what you guys say. I want you to be honest with us, okay? I'll make sure you leave the utmost respect. I want to hear what you...
I think pretty much self-serving statements by Mr. Mgillvary on the Facebook. We're aware of those statements.
What are those statements?
I'm not going to repeat them, even though, you know.
Heroics out in California, right? I mean, this is...
I heard what he...
My understanding, that's why he became an internet sensation. That's why he was on Jimmy Kimmel with the hatchet. He saved two people's lives, basically, is the story. He was in court. He testified against the guy who attacked this other man. Yada, yada, yada. Is that your understanding of why he became this internet sensation and why he has a fan following? And is that how these two fans knew him from that kind of thing?
Obviously the public became enamored of this guy. He became enamored of Castro before he became a murderer. But the reality is that this man was well known, and that doesn't mean that he did not or could not become involved in a crime. We believe he has. We believe he's murdered someone. An attorney, by the way, who was in this county, who was well respected, well regarded, for well over 40 years. So, as far as we're concerned, I don't care who he is. We're looking for him. We consider him the person who murdered Joe Galvin.
I woke up with my pants down, and he's pulling my pants down, and I hit him. I blacked out. And the night before, I'd stayed with him. He picked me up in New York. He says, "Oh, you look lost, you know, like, where are you from, this and that." And I says, "Dog town." He says, "I said I was going to New Jersey." And he said that he was headed to New Jersey too. So I went with him to his house. And when I was at his house, he gave me a bunch of beers. And then I got kind of sleepy right before bed. I woke up and it was like there's a metallic taste in my mouth. And there's like cum moving down the side of my face. And I felt violated. I went over to Asbury to meet a friend, and she wasn't showing up. I called him, didn't have any other place to go. I went and I ate some food with him. He had made some burgers, like some homemade burgers. And then I don't remember much after that. I woke up on his floor, and he was over top of me trying to take my pants down, and I started hitting him. I just blacked out. Okay, so you woke up on the floor? I woke up on the floor of the room. Okay. I'm just going to tell you one more, okay? We made the trip all the way down here, so he died. So just listen to me. We made the trip all the way down here. We want to hear what you guys say. I want you to be honest with us, okay? I'll make sure you leave the utmost respect. I want to hear what you...
So, maybe recorded or monitored.
people have been known when they're taking Ambien to get in their car and drive across the country and then obey all the traffic laws and everything and not remember a single goddamn thing about it.
Wow.
So this is some of the things that they've said under oath. They said all this under oath.
Wow, that's a pretty firm debunking, and at this point, it's really no wonder to me why there's not a lot of media coverage. If it sounds like this guy is kind of protected / connected, the victim rather.
I don't call him a victim at all.
I'm sorry. Oh my gosh, the victimizer, rather. Oh my gosh. Speaking of Freudian slips, I do apologize for that.
Yeah, it's an honest mistake. He's a rapist. There's nothing victim about him.
Right,
and
yeah.
That's one of the things I've run up against here. Is they've already automatically assumed that it can only be one way.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing so, they completely put the blinders on.
Right.
Yeah, so they won't allow themselves to see it any other way now.
Wow. But yeah, no, it sounds like, geez, you've done your homework, and they were sloppy. So at this point, I mean, you know, one can only hope that, you know, the truth shall prevail, you know? Because yeah, it sounds like they aren't even used to. You know, you mentioned the Keystone Cops, it sounded more and more like that. It sounds like they aren't used to having to cover their tracks. Like, they're used to just, you know, and then you just lock them up after he...
Yeah, if I didn't have the support that I did, I wouldn't have a snowball's chance in hell.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'd like to say. You asked earlier on if people can do anything. The fact that they're showing their support by making themselves known online and writing here and... That just making it known that this isn't forgotten. That is making it so that I'm actually getting proper representation. That they're actually being there, standing with me. That alone is help. So if they wanted to go on to the support page and just leave a message and say, yeah, we're here, like we're not forgetting about this. That helps.
Right.
Right. Yeah.
Well, that's good to know. Yeah.
Yeah, if Hurricane Carter had gotten support like that back in the day, that wouldn't happen to him.
Right. Now, yeah. the information you were giving me, is that the USO, the Union Sheriff's Office? Or no, that's the prosecutor's info, right?
That's the document called the Grand Jury Transcript.
Grand Jury Transcript. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, it's in the photo albums in the Facebook support group.
Okay, great. Oh, wow. So now, like, I guess from here, just, what else should we know? What else do you want us to know right now? Seeing as the smallest chunk you could put on there was 25, so, it sounds like, you'll be able to, give me a call and keep me updated from here on out as well, hopefully. But yeah,
okay.
So... for right now though, what should we know? What should I make clear?
There is a motion to dismiss that's coming up that I have been waiting to be before the court for over 2 years now, and that is going to address all of this evidence that got destroyed. And it's really important that people make sure that these officials who are supposed to be representing our interests are actually going to do so.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, like, it seems like such basic stuff. You know, it's like I was telling you about the 15-year-old boy and the... I released that article the other day and shared it on Facebook. This lady who I've never heard of comes up. That's fake. That's not real. You know, it's very real. I mean, I understand that horrible things that shouldn't be able to happen horrible things that shouldn't be able to happen, and it's hard to believe that they could be so. But, you know, unfortunately, just because something is too horrible to be believed, that doesn't mean it can't happen.
Yeah, I'm telling the truth.
Mm-hmm.
I've been in jail now for over 4 years with no trial, and I'm innocent.
Right.
And this is hell.
Mm-hmm.
Duh.
I mean, honestly, when you get out, I hope that you not only get free and completely exonerated, but you should have your law school paid for. You know what I mean? For the years that were stolen.
I get back from surfing for a month or so, I'm definitely going to put a lot of effort in to making sure that people get a fair chance.
Mm-hmm.
People get justice. That people get cared for in ways that are not being provided for right now.
Right. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah. Or at least not my situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, wow. I'm so glad we got a chance to chat today. And I hope that this is just the beginning of not just a dialogue, but, you know, I would hope a friendship.
All right. That sounds great, though.
Hey, and you know what? Expect a letter from me soon as well.
All right. Great. Thank you, man. Hey, when should I look up on Inquisitor for the article to be out?
I'm probably, let's see, as soon as I get off here, I'm going to start writing. Tomorrow's Wednesday, right? Wednesday or Thursday? By Wednesday or Thursday, we should have a couple of bits of coverage.
All right, awesome.
But yeah, definitely.
How are you planning on doing the exposure for? Are you going to do like a 3-part series or something?
At least, yeah. I would like to cover this whole dang thing from the beginning to the end. I want the truth to come out. Yeah. So yeah, we'll start out with this little intro bit, and you know, hopefully, we keep, you know, knock out a piece every week or 2 weeks until you've got justice.
Yeah. All right.
But yeah.
When would you like for me to call you again?
What's a good time?
I usually am allowed out of the cell for 45 minutes every day between 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time.
They still got you on the 23/7?
Yeah.
So you are still in isolation, segregation, or whatever?
Yep, still fed through a slot in the door. Still
you know that's considered cruel and inhuman punishment anyway. Of course, you know that. Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Wow.
But I'm strong. I'll get out of here. I got a stiff upper lip, and I'm doing everything that I can to make sure that I'm sending good vibes to the people who support me, and I'm making sure that I do all the paperwork necessary to get out of here.
You know. I look up to you, kid. You're like a decade or so younger than me, I think. But I look up to you, kid.
I appreciate you, Phil. I'll do my best to be honorable about that.
That's great, yeah. Well, hey, let me let you go. Give me a call tomorrow, whenever's good for you.
All right. You have a good night, Phil.
Yourself as well. God bless, sir.
God bless you, too.
Until later-ish.
I woke up with my pants down, and I was pulling the pants down, and I hit him. I blacked out. And the night before, I'd stayed with him. He picked me up in New York. He says, "Oh, you look lost, you know, like, where are you from, this and that." And I says, "Dogtown." He says, "I said I was going to New Jersey." And he said that he was headed to New Jersey, too. So I went with him to his house, and when I was at his house, He gave me a bunch of beers, and then I got kind of sleepy right before bed. I woke up, and it was like there's a metallic taste in my mouth, and there's like cum going down the side of my face. And I felt violated. I went over to Asbury to meet a friend, and she wasn't showing up. I called Infant, didn't have any other place to go. I went and I ate some food with him. He had made some burgers, like some homemade burgers. And then I don't remember much after that. I woke up on his floor and he was over top me trying to take my pants down and I started hitting him. I just blacked out. Okay, so you woke up on the floor? I woke up on the floor of the room. Okay. I'm just going to tell you one more, okay? We made the trip all the way down here, so he died. So just listen to me. We made the trip all the way down here. We want to hear what you guys say. I want you to be honest with us, okay? I'll make sure you leave the utmost respect. I want to hear what you